I was an iron worker, and I am part of the New York State Wilderness Search and Rescue. And there's very few of us. So I was there for two reasons. Number one, because I'm licensed and certified in search and rescue. And number two, because I was able to get in as an iron worker. We do demolition and removal as well as construction. So I was there on two accounts, not just the one. But like everybody that responded to this, you had a purpose in mind to try to save human life, do a good deed, an act of good Samaritanism for your fellow man. And that's why the biggest problem that suffered out of all of us, if you took the number one symptomatic, it's the psychological trauma that we could not find people alive, that all we found were pieces. I've already buried two of them, Charlie. I worked shoulder to shoulder with them, and I had to go to their wakes. And that kills me. One guy I was friends with for 22 years, but it was something that happened. And knowing that this is gonna be happening more so now, more cancers, more afflictions, more symptomatics are gonna increase, especially those children who were sent to school. Somebody's got to fight for them. And we're lucky we're the most credible not-for-profit organization. Plus, we're recognized by Congress and Senate. So we do what we have to do to stand up for those people. They needed two responders whose testimonies and credibility would be bulletproof. And the ironic part is that it was my partner and I who responded, so both of us got to testify at the Congressional Subcommittee for Government Oversight and Reform.
And what did you tell them?
Exactly what occurred, not only in our eyes, which is somewhat credible, but it had to be things that are documented to prove validity and to perpetuate the reputation of those elected public officials who stand behind us. And all we're doing now for the first time is getting testimony out that this case has gone through government and it has been seen and viewed, and it is clear that testimony has been given as to what the factualities are that are involved. They wanted to know specifically what part we played, how long we were there, and what has occurred to us. But I have never, ever made this about John Sferazo. I always say that even though I was there 29 to 32 days, whatever the actual time is, I am typical of an individual who was there that amount of time with my medical problems and my psychological trauma as well. I think what they really wanted to hear was the part that we played, providing that the credibility that has been accounted for us has been shown and proven. And being the two responders, my partner and I, we had to show how the emotional impact that this administration, the outrage of the responder to an administration that has taken 5.5 years to address a problem and do it so poorly. My part, I felt a drive to show how 9/11 was the first of many subsequent problems such as Katrina, Wilma, and Rita, and how an administration that is sworn to protect and serve those whom they represent, they took an oath, has done nothing but neglected their responsibilities and obligations to us. And history repeats itself. The winner of the battle writes the history books. And history in this case is something that has repeated itself over and over and over. And if somebody doesn't stand fast and try to bring this to light, and with any hope, our administrational functioning as Congress should, we'll do this. We can help to stop this history from repeating itself and to improve life for future generations on the imperfections of this last administration. All along, I've grown up in a family that was 100% military. My father retired as captain of Kings Point Merchant Marine Academy in Great Neck. Every one of my uncles served in the service. My son is in the Air Force. So I believed in my government 100%. So when my administration told us that the air quality was acceptable, there was no reason to doubt them. We figured it was just dust and dirt. But the problem is, the perjury that was committed for the sake and welfare of the almighty dollar, getting Wall Street back up on its feet again, keeping the financial capital of the world floating the way it has been intended to be functioning, in conjunction with control of the media and press, who did not do ample coverage in the very beginning of the perjury and the decimation, and a whole lot of politicians who rode the death and destruction bandwagon of the World Trade Center disaster, promised us the moon, and now I consider them empty promise politicians. Unfortunately, most of America really doesn't know just what kind of dire straits the states who provided the responders, and this is not by any shape or form a New York City problem. This stretches from coast to coast, from northern boundary to southern boundary, and we have people from all over, including Germany, England, Ireland. I could name so many. Australia, New Zealand, that helped in this cleanup and recovery. But initially it was a search and rescue effort until we made a conclusion that there was no life still alive in that pile. We all had the highest hopes, and it was just one immense act of good Samaritanism. And unfortunately, many of our public elected officials rode a bandwagon of photo opportunities and personal gain, and they've delivered such empty promises. So now, those elected public officials who are standing forward, such as Congressman Bill Pascrell from New Jersey, Senator Joe Vitale from New Jersey, here are two individuals who really have Jersey residents' welfare in mind. People don't realize how beneficial it is to have a state senator and a congressional member on the same side. We're lucky we have quite a few in New York, Connecticut, and this is most importantly a bipartisan issue. This is not just one party or another. This is a bipartisan agenda, and most of the Northeast delegation is united over this. But when I say Northeast, why do we not say the West? Why do we not say the Northwest, or the Southwest, or the Southeast? They really are knowledgeable about the extent, as we up here are not privy to all the knowledge of Katrina's decimation. They themselves in other locations are not privy to the devastation and the extent of not 9/11 disaster, but the 9/11 epidemic. We're looking at 650,000+ people who are currently symptomatic or afflicted. What are those numbers going to grow to into the next 5 years? From day one of our inception of the Unsung Heroes Helping Heroes, we have been pushing for a presumption law where there is no statute of limitations. A presumption law that is not only state recognized, but federally recognized, where now once a responder has an involvement with the disaster, sees a medical professional, the medical professional in his or her findings states the afflictions and symptomatics that has been observed upon that client. When that patient now gets the results from his or her medical professional, they have a 2-year window to create a claim. So it's a presumption law we've been pushing for on state and federal level. And most importantly, we want a proven emergency disaster response intact with, again, federal and state municipalities, departments, and agencies. One that we show that our administration has perjured itself enough times in the past where we cannot believe what they tell us. We want a proven emergency disaster response so we know if there is another tragedy or disaster, history will not repeat itself again.